Hey everybody, it's me, Matt Rogers, letting you know tickets are on sale now to see me on tour. The Prince of Christmas tour, that is. I'm doing my whole album, Have You Heard of Christmas, plus a lot more with the whole band all throughout December. Go to www.mattrogersofficial.com to see me in a city near you. And now, Las Cultch. Drums.
Look, Matt.
Where?
Oh, I see. My, oh, my. Bowen, look over there.
Wow, is that Ooh. Culture?
Oh, yes.
Oh, my goodness.
Cool. Wow. Yeah.
Las Culturistas.
Ding dong, Las Culturistas calling.
Tactile as fuck.
Tactile AF.
AF.
AF? I was actually, like, I've been smiling and beaming all day. I woke up with a giggle.
Oh my God.
I sort of leapt out of bed and then I looked at myself in the mirror and then I immediately got sad because I think I'm actually developing a sty.
Blepharitis.
What? No, it's if you develop a sty, you just nip it in the bud and you put rice in a sock, you put it in the microwave for 30 seconds and then you just warm compress.
Is that the cure?
Mm-hmm.
All right, good.
I was all nervous today because I literally was so excited for this. I got a facial yesterday.
I got a facial for the episode.
Oh, fun.
I went to the Equinox Spa and Hotel, which is in Hudson Yards, really the best area of New York. Remember when I was looking for an apartment in Hudson Yards?
And I don't think I gave you any guff for it. I was like, if that's where Matt is happiest, Matt belongs at the theme park of New York City.
Although, and this is what I wanted to tell you. Yeah, go.
But are you, what do you, how do you feel about Rockefeller Center making a real play at being the only real technical zoned theme park in New York? Because that's what they're trying to do.
As the Prince of Rockefeller Center. And I do, I actually have to say, we actually are the royal court of Rockefeller Center, if you think about it.
We're the jesters in the court.
So as a representative of the zone, I couldn't be prouder of my sisters who are making that place a theme park.
They really
are
doing
it. Very happy about it.
It's ticketed rides. You got to strap on a seatbelt.
You can go to the, you know, I've gone to the top of yes. the Rockefeller Center and like you go on the beam and it spins around. It's very thrilling. You would love it, oh. I think. Not yet, though.
Is that my cue?
No.
Not yet.
So, never mind.
Don't worry.
So
we'll get
so
into it.
So if you sort of just like heard the voice.
What?
I'm so sorry.
No, come on.
I'm so sorry. I just need you to stay. Oh, Dave, you got it?
How would you like me? This way?
No, Bowen, you're actually leaning to your right, which you I know you feel natural. Can we go a touch to our left?
Touch
feet?
Yeah.
Yes, sorry to bring your flow, guys. I'm so sorry. Just the tiniest.
I'm getting a lot. So what do you want me to do?
I just need you to go to your keep to your left a little bit so you can stay out of her single.
Single is, yes, of course.
Thank you so much.
Perfect.
Sorry,
no problem.
No, it's okay. I'm really glad it's that and not what I thought it was.
What was it?
I thought she was coming in like, guys, there's a fire. We got to get out of here. Come on.
Use all this.
Stairs only.
Wait.
That's where my
of,
mind goes.
I
she
know.
Came in and I was like, something's happening.
She had the energy of like, it's an emergency.
That was emergency energy.
The hair, the way the hair moved was urgent.
Gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
It was
gorgeous
stunning.
And scary.
A curtain.
Excited and scared.
Here we go.
No, we're back. We're using all of that.
We're using
all of it was used is being used, and I won't.
Even the part where I got a little snippy, I was like, I'm getting a lot. What do you want me to do?
No, honestly, like that's authenticity, Bo. And
sure.
That's why people love Las Culturistas with Matt Rogers and Bowen Yang, because this is a real ass show.
Oh, yeah.
I agree.
And that was a real moment. And here's what I really want to say. You've said the theme park thing. Do you know how I spent my morning? I've been thinking about the Wicked theme park ride all day. I've seen the film. And I want to unveil like what I think the experience of the theme park ride at Epic Universe, put it in between. There's a spot for it. You put it in between Super Nintendo World and the Dark Universe. I feel like that's a perfect meeting for Wicked. It's Emerald City / Oz, whatever they want to do. And
yep.
I can't wait to pitch to our guest my idea for the theme park ride. The story of it.
Okay.
Because I know we're with one of the true girlies.
We're with one of the true Floridian girlies. Let's bring her in.
Talk about your pal.
She literally saved my life. I can't even look at you.
I
fucking love you. She's the legend. She's playing Glinda in Wicked Part 1, maybe Part 2. She's playing Glinda.
You'll have to wait to see what happens at the end of Act 1. Does the character die?
Who knows? John
is there
M.
a death? Imagine the twist of like they killed Glinda
they
in the first one.
Glinda.
like, oh my God, they really took a swing.
Fuck.
That sucks. We loved her performance in the first.
I know. If the Munchkins in Munchkin Land.
It's like a dark Wicked, like
oh
the
my
Dark
God.
Knight. Our guest is a singular talent, an icon, I mean, I am a fan. I've always been a fan. This is surreal. I can't believe she's here. I mean, Eternal Sunshine, one of the albums of the year, like, to say nothing of everything else she's ever put out. I mean, I can't believe this is happening. It's the film of the year, Wicked. And this guest you're about to welcome into your ears is the one, the fucking only, Ariana Grande.
Thank you. That's my cue.
Yeah.
I've been tempted to jump in every third sentence.
That's sort of the vibe.
So sorry. I know, but it's just been so tempting.
We really work our guests up and then they chime in and then they're ready to go. Okay, so
Hi. Thank you for having me.
This is a blessing. And a half and three quarters.
Is this weird? No, this is perfection. Okay.
Do you want to know the Wicked theme park ride?
Tell me now.
Because you want this to happen.
Of course I do. And I have ideas as well.
Okay, so let's collab. I think you go to, like, it's not Shiz, it's the Emerald City. Mm-hmm. And the vibe is like, Glinda live today is going to address everyone, the Aussians. It's like we're all going.
You're already taking it.
It's like, okay, so it's.
I'm already thinking about when we're going to have to shoot that.
Oh, tomorrow. God, yeah.
We can always figure
it out.
I think about that sometimes, you know?
Yeah, like shooting like the theme park B-roll later.
Yeah, shooting like, you know, Hermione being like, don't forget to wear your seatbelts.
Yeah.
You know, like that vibe.
Sometimes I feel like, are they still doing that? Are they going to go out to like D. Radcliffe and
I think they're on contract and so they're locked into something. Can you do your Hermione impression? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Ron's been speeched. That?
Been spleached?
Harry! Ron's been spleeched.
Perfect.
Whatever. Oh my God, yeah, there is something in the nose.
Ron!
There is. What is that?
No, you can't. I love the vocal fray so much.
Yeah. The vocal what?
The fray. Vocal fray.
The fray. Oh my God.
I love it so much.
Yeah. Okay, so Glinda is addressing.
Today, Glinda live. Like, it's you and then we as the guests coming in are going to like see the speech and then something is like happening. So this takes place between Wicked 1 and 2.
Okay.
So in that area.
Oh, that's fun. That's fun.
Like, so it's like we believe that Elphaba's like afoot.
Yeah.
Like, there's signs that are like, get the witch. You know what I mean? Like, da-da-da.
Right,
right. And then, like, we get in the ride. And I don't know the like, rest of this, but, like, that's the setup. And, like, you are, like, get ready to speak. And then there's, like, weather.
Weather.
Morrible.
Seats start to move. We think it's Elphaba, but we know it's
Morrible.
So, Michelle Yeoh going.
Yes.
Listen!
Yes.
Don't let her get away!
If you want. That's the best shot in the whole thing.
It's the best. When she turns.
And the monkeys go, oh my God.
Fuck.
This.
It's the best shot of any movie I've ever seen in my life. No. She's so hot. She's so beautiful and regal and powerful.
And when she goes, Wicked Witch.
Yes. What a choice to get quiet.
Wicked Witch. Oh, Witch. Please. I love Michelle.
She's brilliant.
I've seen it. I DM'd you. I'm blown away by the movie. And it's just like, you guys, to leave the fake world of the theme park right now, like, okay, we'll figure it out. Like, TKTK theme park ride, the very real film, is so brilliant. And, like, you know it. You know it. Wicked's is a film about Fanny.
It is.
He's a gay boy. Who wants to make it big in the world, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what the film is.
He knows that, the media landscape of Oz is not ready for a fop.
Very
like him.
Homophobic city.
A homophobic country.
I have the best video in the world of you rehearsing at Shiz. It's been in my drafts for 2 years.
Post.
Of him. His little pink, like, cap over your hair because we weren't ready to film yet with your little clips in.
Uh-huh.
And he's, like, half in wardrobe, half in, like, some cute, like, Bowen thing.
Yep.
Ugh. And he's just like, what did he say? Wait, what did Madame Morrow say? Elphaba mustn't get wet. All right, fine, I'm gay. Shiz,
I'm
but
gay.
But I don't want that to be the most interesting thing about me.
Yeah, because
I've watched it 300 times.
Honestly.
How do we feel about the original person who read for Fanny at the table read for Wicked was Sutton Foster?
What?
Have I desecrated Sutton's name?
Wait, no. What are you talking about?
So, like, in the original sort of, like, table read for Wicked, before any of the shows, any of the tryouts.
That was Sutton Foster?
They had Idina and they had Kristen, but then they had Sutton Foster. was Fanny.
Years ago?
The most important thing I've ever heard.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
That is so spectacular.
Like circa 2001 or whatever.
How did I not know this?
No, I didn't know this either until people like were sending like sending it to me.
Oh my
Isn't
God.
That crazy?
I mean, she's going to be so floored and proud. And
no way.
She's going, absolutely.
She walked
Can we talk
so you
about
could run. And I've been saying that for years.
His brilliance in this film?
I mean, he lights up the screen like he
screen.
Lights up my life. Every time you come
and
on
mine.
Screen, I'm like, in a word, period.
Just so incredibly brilliant. And I also just want like a string out of everything you said because
yeah. String out.
I really do. I want a string out. Let's bring string outs back.
I love string
Can we just
out.
String out today.
I want a string out of everything he said on that set.
Yeah. Yeah.
I got to see last night
what?
Because Cynthia and I went to go do like watch along and make commentary thing.
Oh, fun.
But while we were there, they showed us deleted scenes.
Oh.
And I got to see I've Been Through.
Oh my God. Wait, they kept
I've Been Through.
Talk about that so everyone knows.
So they did, spoiler alert, they did cut the scene where Glinda meets Fanny and Shen Shen again.
But it's very cute and you will get to see it.
Oh, okay. Really?
You will get to see it. It's coming out.
Because I want to see it. That was my one notice. I was like, well, who are they?
Who are these
we kind of just made it all up.
Yeah,
we kind of just
love
like, they were, John was like, all right, you guys meet here.
Uh-huh.
And maybe you do a little, you know, and we were like, perfect,
sure.
We'll do it. And so we did the weird dance thing, whatever it was.
We did the weird dance thing, and then
I was like, how are you guys really?
And then, yeah, so Ari is going to go, so how are you? Oh, it's been so long. How are you guys really? And then I, for some reason, made the choice to go, I've been through.
And we said, I've been through for 2 years after that.
I've been through.
Been
and then
through.
And the other phrase was, I have had scandal.
I have had scandal.
Belongs in the movie.
I have had scandal.
Title
of it. I have had scandal.
I've been through.
I've been through.
Which
I
we
love
all
I've
have.
Been through.
I've been through is.
Not it.
No.
I've been through.
I've been through.
Just I've been through. And we just all collapsed. It was so ticklish. It was so funny.
Thanks, baby.
There was the coolest waitress I used to waitress with would always say, oh my God, that person is so. And never ever said the word after.
That's the safe thing to do.
That's very
you
safe.
That's really safe.
Knew. Like,
you know?
Oh, how was Ari? She was so.
And then you get to, you know.
Fill in the blank.
It's
Let
a lot
the other
about
person
how
project.
You say so. Exactly.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's an invitation for more projection.
It protects and projects.
But yes, it protects and projects. Wait, but you saying I've been through uh-huh. is so funny to me because that's like minute three of the film.
It's too much.
It's so funny.
I understand why it's cut because it makes no tonal sense with the rest of the film.
It lives on its own, but in the most brilliant way.
Right. Yeah.
The
why?
Same way that I don't see color. Lives on its own.
Do we think? Do we think that comes to real?
No, it's so funny and it's so brilliant, and
it's also good.
Like, yeah, we're commenting on what we're commenting on
sure,
in this film.
Sure.
It's actually the most brilliant comedic way of saying, yeah, that's what this is about.
But
yeah.
I can't believe. I find it miraculous that stayed in the final
cut. It's the best. I was hoping and praying. I had literally my fingers and toes crossed. It was sitting in the audience. Watching for the very first time, and I literally, John Chu was sitting right next to me, and I literally was like,
thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
I was like, thank God. Thank goodness,
we
honestly.
We need some Bowen Yang ad-libs in the final cut.
You guys, there's something terrible about an ad-lib that you do on set because you're with like a friend and you're disarmed and you're being stupid, and then you see it, and then you go, well, fuck, a gajillion people are going to watch me do this stupid
and have a lot of feelings about it as mm-hmm. well and be, you know,
totally
that's like once you leave the set and mm-hmm. you're like, the fuck did we just what just
yeah.
happened
just
oh my
god,
that's what we filmed,
right?
Yeah.
hope anything's okay,
right?
Yeah, it's like, wow, I feel like I blacked out for 2 years and now I'm like, oh
right,
good
it's
morning
now the people are coming
in, come on
come
in
come
the
on
fans
in.
Of Wicked are gonna sit there and be like, we have a lot of feelings about what this has always been to us, and now this is the film,
which is such a beautiful, which is such a beautiful blessing and responsibility to
yeah.
have as
mm-hmm.
people who also love it and
yes.
have lived for this for 20 years
yes.
and have
mm-hmm.
done the research, like read the L. Frank Baum books and done their homework and have lived it and loved it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's such a beautiful celebration.
Yes.
And
yeah.
we welcome the feelings.
We welcome the feelings.
I'm a fangirl with those feelings about the things I love.
Totally.
Yeah, of course.
To quote the show, I ask you a question. What is this feeling now for you? Like,
so sudden and new.
So sudden and new. 2 years, like, it was like 2 years of your life where you were like monastic. You were a monk being like, I'm going to like be so disciplined about this. And now I feel like it happened yesterday. And now all of a sudden we're like, oh fuck, we have to like, in a way, like relive what happened and then also like package it into a way that like feels good for a soundbite.
Right. And promote and sell the thing. Mm. And it's just like, it takes this transition from being this intimate, really real feeling thing to us talking about it like it's a product.
Yeah.
And it's a very strange shift, but I'm really trying to hold on to the humanness of it all and kind of just like, let that be what we talk about. Cause it's so exciting to be able to talk about it.
Yeah.
So it doesn't feel like a press tour the way it has maybe when I was doing it for music or something like that, because it feels, I don't know, it feels different for a million reasons.
Of course.
I don't know.
Because you know what we kept saying when we shot it was like, it just feels like we're shooting a little indie.
A little student film.
A student film.
Right. Like all of a sudden there's like a mark.
Yes.
Uh-huh. There's like, I'm stepping on tape to do Wicked. Like, it's never been done like this before, and yet we're committing it.
Yeah, that wall broke when there was, like, a man on a hang glider with a camera in the sky.
Right.
And it was, like, Daily Mail on a parachute. We were like, oh, wait. Shit.
Yeah, so...
Oh, sure. Oh, it's
crazy.
That. Yeah.
So someone flew in to try to get, like, footage.
Multiple people.
Got a lot.
I actually saw it on Twitter, and I was like, wait, what? It was, like, literally from, like, hundreds of yards away. Like,
yes.
I think you could hear you doing your, like, coloratura.
Right. There was a, like, that was one of the rehearsals. And they were, like, all the way across the water, there was a little, like, pond thing.
Yeah.
And
there was a body of water.
I'm big on water.
Small water sign.
One thing about Ariana, she knows her bodies of water.
This now, cancer, she knows
cancer.
Water.
Yes. She no,
and she'll talk about it.
Yeah. I will. Across the way, there was.
We're going to call it a brook.
Uh-huh. There, across the brook.
Over the brook.
Yes. There was a ladder.
There was a gay guy in a parachute.
There was
with
a gay guy with a camera.
The worst kind.
And I said,
a flying gay guy with a camera.
Bowen, what are you doing over there?
Get down from there. We need you for the shot, damn it.
I was doing my fanny coming out of the closet. But no, it was a guy. It was a guy sending a drone. It was a guy sending a drone up.
Yeah, but my favorite thing about it was like, I was like, I'm easy peasy. I was like, oh, it's, you know, whatever. If you know, Mark doesn't have a problem with it or John is okay, like, I'm going to just like, do my job. I'll ignore it and I'll block it out. Blinders on, whatever. Mm. But like, you know, a lot of people were concerned because it's a big deal, you know, for that to come out before it's supposed to come out. But no one really cared that much.
Did anything about it.
Yeah, they were like this. They were like this.
Well, what are they going to do exactly?
And I was like this. Yeah, totally. I think I heard that there's people and I think I just saw some stuff.
Uh-huh.
And they were like, oh,
man. Dang.
Well, from the top, everyone. Yeah. And I was like, oh, that's amazing. That's really cool.
It is cool. People.
I was like, if you don't care, I don't care.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Yeah, freeing.
Because you feel like people, it's like, and we love and we bless the people whose concern and job it is to like make sure things are like secure and safe and like
absolutely.
Not seen. But sometimes it is like other people kind of like working you up.
Right.
And into thinking that it's a huge problem when you're like, when deep down, like in your person, you're like, oh, it's fine. Like, I'll just keep doing what I do.
Yeah. And we were all kept very safe. And like, there was never any sort of like danger in that way.
Yeah.
And there's only so much you can do when we're shooting on these like massive outdoor sets.
Yeah.
So instead of having everyone stress about it and become like anxious, like you said, and you know, if there wasn't anything that we could do, we just started to have fun with it. Like when the drones would come, me and the munchkins would be like, hello.
Hey.
And then I started like taking my wand and being like, okay, that's enough. Like,
yeah.
Go away.
Yeah.
Trying to make it fun. But, you know, it's crazy.
Question. When did this happen? Like, when did you guys know it was friendship and not just like a colleague I enjoy?
I mean, I was so, so over the moon excited that you were going to be able
doing
to do
it.
I called Lauren.
You did. You got
on
the phone.
Did you know
about
this?
I knew about
this. Is that okay that I...
No, reveal.
I talk
no, reveal.
About this?
It's almost like you're comfortable.
Well, because I knew that it was a huge... massive
ask
yeah. And also probably an impossible one.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have anything, any sort of resolution to pitch him, but I just called him and I was like, hi, Lauren. Oh my goodness. How are you? And he was like, hello, Ariana. What's going on?
Really
and I was
good.
Like, is there any way? Is there any way?
And scoop the doll.
That was the most nervous I've ever been. But, you know, we made it work.
He made it work.
You made it work. You exhausted yourself and worked yourself to the bone.
Yes. It's the only time that I've ever pulled like a pouty face in front of him to be like, I really want to do this. And then he was like, okay,
we'll do that again because it was cute as fuck.
Yes.
Show them what you did.
I was like, I really want to do this. And then I did. I basically did that.
It was really tough what you put yourself through.
But yes,
it was,
but no regrets.
You were amazing.
Zero regrets.
And I think the answer to the question is the minute you got there, I was just kind of like, oh my goodness, I hope that he is having the same experience that I'm having. Because I really want to be friends. You know what I mean?
It was a star shower when I saw you, when we met for the first time.
The stars exploded. A collision.
The stars exploded. It was at Leavesden. We were doing rehearsals.
Yes.
And then I remember like I was in my little room, I was reading a book, and then you came in and
barged in.
No, it was so perfect.
I was too excited.
No, you weren't.
I love it.
Cynthia came in and gave me Grethers and she was so fucking sweet. I'll never forget it. And then you came in and then like it was like I just like it was a meteor shower around you. And I was like, oh, this is so fun. I think the moment that it was like friends, I think, was when we watched Mommy Dearest together and then VHS.
Right. Yes.
Loves horror. You guys don't totally align on this, but Ari is a huge horror freak.
Oh, you're a horror freak.
I am. And
the way you said that, Ari is a huge horror freak.
Is that, did that sound bad?
No, great.
Okay.
I've heard a lot worse. But yeah, no, that's lovely. Thank you.
You're a horror freak.
Kindness. A massive kindness. Thank you.
What's your horror? Pick. What's the best horror film?
I don't know. I really like... What are you
Did you see the second?
You loved VHS, and I'm just thinking because I watched Smile last night alone in my apartment.
Smile 2 or 1?
Smile 1, because I want to see Smile 2 and Smile 1.
I would go tonight. Let's go as soon as we can.
Go.
I wish I could
And know. How did you feel?
It was disturbing.
It's a good one.
You like
really
it.
Good one. I do.
Sosie Bacon star.
Love Sosie.
So fucking good.
She is a talent.
She's a talent. But God, that ending was... That ending is crazy.
It's a lot,
It's a lot.
So
but I love that.
I love that.
I love heart. Wait, apparently.
Well, because apparently Smile 2 also ends in a way that you're like.
Yeah, let's go.
Let's go.
You don't like, though.
I get really anxious, upset, scared, freaked out, frustrated, and more.
I got you.
You got me? You're going to protect me out there? You know what? You know what I do, though?
What?
Haunted House. And we just did the sickest.
Oh, my God.
Talk about this. We were truly in the woods in Pennsylvania. We were
where in Pennsylvania?
The Poconos.
Oh my gosh, okay.
Yeah, so Sudie, Bowen, and I went just to like get a little fall moment.
Right.
It was like an unassuming haunted house. Like, it's like, oh, this is like in the middle of nowhere. It's not going to be like budget.
No, but those
it's not
are the
gonna
ones. Like, those are the ones.
Those are the ones.
Those are the ones.
Because there wasn't that many people there, which meant the groups, when you're traveling through, were small. It's not like... Halloween Horror Nights, where it's like
you have to sign 30,000
people are there,
and you have to sign like waivers and stuff.
See, we didn't sign
no
that's
waivers.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. When there's no waivers, all bets are off.
Yeah, but
it's gonna be scary.
Usually, though, if they touch you, you're supposed to have signed a waiver. We were getting really harangued by these people, and I loved every second of
it. But that's what I'm saying. There's no waiver in place, so they really can.
So they get
Wild West, the Wild Poconos.
Yeah.
We were in the Wild Poconos at the craziest haunted house you can think of.
I want to go now.
It was 40 minutes long. How long was it?
Ooh,
I swear to God,
no breaks.
No breaks.
No breaks. Relentless horror.
How do you feel?
How
about
much
that?
Space did that take up?
It was a big footprint.
Was it like a 2 mile?
Yeah,
extravaganza.
It was a big footprint, like a compound, basically. It was. We stayed at this resort And like the guys, like as they bring you in, they're like, okay, guys, so it's a bunch of actors, but like they're just doing their job. So
People work in the kitchen at the resort.
They said like these people work in the kitchen, so it's like low. So we were like, okay, so it's low stakes. Not at all. It was insane.
Well, they're letting it out.
They're letting it out.
They're letting it out.
Oh, the screams were not safe.
Right.
Let's just say they came from here.
Yeah.
Like it was like a woman flying out of a corner. Like what?
Do it.
It was you. I'll do it. It was like this. It was like, get out! Help, please, out!
I love screaming.
And we were just
screaming.
That's divine.
The only way you can respond to that is with a scream at that level yourself. So we were just like, ah!
Right. I love when you scream.
Yeah, he's the best screamer.
Much.
How do you feel as a professional celebrated vocalist?
Oh, wow.
What is your...
Sure, thank you.
Is this your first time hearing of this?
That is, I needed that.
Yeah.
What is your opinion on screaming? Because some people, it's divisive.
How do you scream?
Oh, like that.
See, and wait, for that to have happened in the second, wait. By the way, we saw how she screamed, and it's like this. It was giving the soft palate.
Yes.
Look at her. She cleans up her own ice coffee. Ariana Grande, everybody.
Do we get that? Kiss my ass.
Kiss my ass. Fuck up. Oh, I loved getting that look from her.
Oh my, God,
oh my gosh.
Gee whiz. Wait, what is your opinion on screaming?
Yeah, how do you scream?
I don't, listen.
You're at Halloween Horror Nights and something.
She kind of did it though. She went, woo.
No, that's not my. That's not my. That's not that. I think it's like.
You don't have to do it. I'm sorry.
I'd like to. Please, thank you. No, I'd like to.
We're gonna hear it.
No, I don't know. I think it depends on the context.
Uh-huh.
But screaming is weird because sometimes I guess I subconsciously scream in a healthy way.
Yeah.
Because sometimes after I scream, like there were several scenes in Wicked where there's lots of screaming, and I was like, oh my, I love screaming.
Yeah.
But afterwards, I felt like warmed up.
Yeah.
Or something. So maybe I subconsciously scream healthily.
Yeah.
But I actually don't know that I intentionally. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, like, there are ways to do it, but I don't think it's something I choose when in fear.
Totally. Does this inspire or motivate you to do a horror movie? Like,
well,
you know, it depends on the context.
Yes.
It depends on the script.
Yes.
I'm not like a gore for the sake of gore person.
Totally. Okay.
And I also, like, I don't know, I would want to do a great job. I'd want to do an incredible job.
Of course.
So it really depends. If I could lend myself to the character in a way that I felt would be really purposeful and great, then sure. But
for
a dream project. But I like horror that is
psychological.
Thoughtful. Yeah, thoughtful. Not just blood for fun.
Yeah.
Totally. What would you categorize VHS?
Blood for fun.
Title of that. What would you categorize VHS as?
Oof. I mean...
No, we don't have to talk about it. Really, it's actually rough. a really rough movie.
I make you watch that?
Because you were being a good friend and I was going through a hard time.
But that's
you
like wanted... not the thing to watch when you're going through a hard
time. It is.
It's so anxious-making.
It was cathartic.
Okay.
Did you feel better afterwards?
You sure weren't thinking about whatever you came there thinking about.
Period. And also, we did
It's really scary.
We didn't enjoy... Yeah. Not that we didn't enjoy the whole thing, but we did not stick with it because at a certain point, Ari goes...
I've never seen the whole thing.
Yeah.
Do you turn movies off before they're over a lot? No, just VHS.
Yeah.
No, because it's little vignettes.
It's vignettes.
And I love the first vignette because this like fierce goblin woman like rips seven dicks off and flies
fierce
into the
goblin
sky.
Woman.
Like, she's just like, it's really cool.
And her face splits
and she's gorgeous and cool and like kills.
Are you going to see The Substance?
I am going to see The Substance. I'm dying to see it.
Yeah, I heard it's... Yeah. Incredible. Everyone I'm talking to that's seeing it is like, I can't stop thinking about it.
I need to see it.
Yeah.
I'm really excited to see
October 31st on Mubi.
But that's not my favorite horror film. I feel like that's going to like lead people to think I don't know.
Would you have a favorite?
Would I like to address this problem?
Yes, you don't have to.
No, I'm kidding. What's your favorite horror film?
I don't know it too well. I'm not very literate, but I think I'm going to say, oh God. I am going to say, recently I really did love...
are you going to say...
What?
The one...
No, not The Hills Have Eyes.
No, girl, please.
No way.
Not that.
No.
The one where it was like the demon came out of her head. The one that was on HBO Max.
Oh,
you know what I'm saying?
Oh.
Malignant?
Yes,
Malignant.
Because didn't you love Malignant?
I didn't see Malignant.
Joel loved Malignant.
What was the other one?
It's such a joyfully chaotic scene.
Yeah. Totally.
It's crazy.
See, I appreciate complete insanity. Back when I was watching them, like, if it would get completely absurd, like, I loved Saw, the first Saw.
Right, because it's so brilliant.
It's so brilliant. The way it comes together in the montage, I was like, oh my God, I didn't know I was watching art the whole time.
I can endure that much gore if it's that smart.
If it pays off.
If it's that smart.
Yes.
I love it so much.
Yeah.
Just to switch gears, I really have to apologize to you in person.
For what?
I opened my mouth up too much when we kissed on SNL.
You absolutely did. I was shaking with laughter.
Really?
No, not in a bad way.
I'm so
not in
sorry.
A bad way. In just like a disarming way. Because you know what? Like the rehearsal.
The chemistry was so good.
Oh my gosh, thank you. I mean, it comes from a real place.
I know it
place,
does.
But I kissed you too much.
You know what? That's okay.
No,
and
it's
I
not.
Know we were really
and
dropped
you were thinking
in.
About that?
We were dropped
we
in.
Were
we were
dropped. We
were dropped in
back.
And it felt like what these people needed at that time. It felt like what these characters
it was motivated.
Required.
Yeah. Yes. A little
and
open mouth.
I'm all for it.
Yeah. I just should we talk about like what how we arrived at it? Because there was not a kiss originally.
Right, no, there wasn't a kiss
originally.
Whose
idea was it?
Well, that here's the thing. Go you,
No,
go
you
ahead.
Go, you go, you go.
No, I mean when we rehearsed it, a little I don't know.
Something
thought,
went off.
Yeah, in my head and I was like, I didn't say anything because I was like, oh, everyone's gonna think I'm absolutely insane and too comfortable. Yeah. But I was like, oh, how funny would it be if we kissed at the end?
Yeah.
And then Bowen texts me a few hours later and was like, it's totally fine. This is way too crazy. But we were talking and thought it would be so funny if we kissed at the end. And I was like, wow.
What if we kissed?
Thanks.
About that.
Yeah. I was like, wow, I was thinking that. I'm so sorry.
And you were immediately on board.
Yes.
So do you rehearse it? Do you do it in dress? Or like, what's, because I always feel like with rehearsing a kissing thing,
oh.
It's, I've only had to do it a few times, but it's like the rehearsal of it is like, are we doing it?
It's
are we
so
doing
uncomfortable.
A version of it?
Right.
Like, what is it?
Yeah, it's like, shit, are we reading for real this time?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Are we kissing this time or no?
So what was it?
We kissed
every
in the dress
time.
Rehearsal.
We kissed in the dress rehearsal, but in the, and I will admit.
We had a very grown-up conversation about it. We said, we doing it or not?
Did have a grown-up conversation
she
just like that.
She came out a little bit there
doing
as well.
It. We doing it or not?
Sorry, just talking about
Joan.
Her, she comes out sometimes.
Yeah, that was Joan.
Sorry.
Well, are we doing it or not?
Well, I also have to apologize. I think in the grand scheme of things, I was maybe a little overeager. Because
no.
run-through on Saturday, so on Saturdays in the
you
afternoons, well, I go.
Looking
hey.
Good?
I was like, so should we do it? I didn't say, do you want to do it for run through? I said, I phrased it in like a leading way of like, should we? And you were like,
shall we kiss?
No, I feel like, well, because there was, we talked about maybe waiting till the real thing, just to like
see
wing
what
it and
yeah,
see
totally.
How it was.
Get the
I was
real
like,
moment.
Let it be on the live, yeah. You know, the first time. But then we were like, no, let's be adults. Let's rehearse it just so we know
yes.
how it feels and not have that surprise on live television.
And so,
we just
your
it.
Take on it. And just talk to me.
Yeah,
so,
absolutely. Sure.
So his mouth was a little too open.
No. That came from him, not from me.
But you acknowledge,
but
you said you absolutely did open
it
your mouth.
It was absolutely too open. No, I'm kidding.
It was a little too
I'm
open,
kidding.
But their
no.
chemistry.
For the characters,
yeah.
I think it was perfectly open.
I would agree. I was watching it. And I'm thinking to
I did
myself,
start shaking, giggling.
Yeah.
See.
Well, you got
yeah,
it.
Yeah, absolutely. I broke. I was like.
You're like, what is this gay guy doing?
Yeah, you're with
it
him.
It seemed incredibly purposeful and motivated.
Good.
And it felt incredible.
As speaking, long as that's how it felt for the audience.
Yes.
It's all good here.
Speaking of your mom, have you ever told Ari?
And no beef here. It's official.
Wait, can we quickly brief about how SNL was for you, because that was
oh
that was
gosh.
A top tier A plus all time perfect episode.
Thank you. That's
it really
I
was.
Mean, thank you. I had the time of my life. I would have done it right after we finished at 1 a.m. again.
Yeah.
Like I really love being there. I love every single person there. Like I just had the loveliest best time with everyone.
Mm.
And I love laughing. I love comedy. I love bits.
You're so good at it.
Thank you.
And also you can
thank
tell
you.
It leads from a joy that you have to do it and like a motivation to like work hard and get it right. And I also can't believe you've only hosted twice. You give the energy of someone that's been there
that's
again
so
and
nice.
Again. It throws
that is
back
so nice.
To like how good JT was
JT.
At the show back in the day of like, you know, coming in. Like, what do you think it is that prepares you to do something like Saturday Night Live so well?
Oh my gosh. I don't know. I mean, that's really nice. I think I find like a comfortability in getting to know everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I love getting to know people when I come to a place.
Yeah.
I want to like befriend everyone and be open. And when you're meeting all the writers and collaborating with everyone is super just kind of open and talk about where you can go, like when trying things and whatever. It just is a really safe and fun experience. I don't know. It's like constant, but it's the best and it's so much fun. And I think I just love comedy. So maybe that is like why I was so excited to go, and I felt very excited. I think when it comes to doing big, exciting things, sometimes, you know, it can become like a scary, daunting thing. But if you hold on to excitement and gratitude and let that like fuel the whole experience, it can really change the tone of everything.
Right.
It's something I like learned in my late 20s.
Yeah.
But no, I don't know. It's just, it felt really fun.
The return to Saturn brought joy.
Oh, yes.
It brought comfort.
Yeah.
Also, texting with Bowen constantly.
Your friend
having
is there.
Having a literal best friend there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And in the weeks leading up, I felt like I was bothering you because it's my turn to apologize now.
And imagine looking at your phone at Ariana Grande.
No, I felt like I was I felt like I was blowing you up because I couldn't stop like texting insane like ideas for bits and like silly things, and I was just so excited to get there.
Yeah.
So maybe that's why. I think when you're excited,
about
work,
the people.
Yes. Yeah. And your work.
And the work. Yeah.
It shows.
It's
I don't know.
It's a team.
Yeah.
Almost like it's like, and with Wicked too. And I was just going to like posit that maybe, like, when you get the audition for Glinda, right? That has to be a thing where you're like, holy fuck. Like, it's something I've thought about for a very long time.
Yeah.
Like, it's one of those roles that's going to be, someone's going to get it and it's going to feel like, yes, incredible, that person, but like a little part of you is like, oh God. And so when you get that audition, I wonder, is it all just like joy and like, how do you approach the comedy of something that's so iconically done and like you respect, but you bring yourself to it because you do that.
Yes.
Well, thank you. I think it's kind of like, it was one of the most important parts to me was finding that balance between like honoring the iconic Glinda that we have had on the soundtrack for 21 years and the role that was like written really by Winnie Holtzman and Kristen Chenoweth. Like, you know, honoring what made it so iconic, which is like the original material and, you know, people, while also kind of like bringing myself to it. And, I don't know, sort of, it's interesting because knowing something and being a fan of something for such a long time is very different than having to become it and sort of take it on. So I don't know. I mean, a lot of just like trying and playing and reading the script 100 times fully through, even before the audition, like not the movie one, the Broadway one. So that sort of, you know, choices of my own could come through and finding new truths to little beats and moments that play differently on stage because this isn't the stage show. And finding that balance was, of course, the most important thing because I know as a fan of it how important it is to walk that line. And, you know, that's really all you can do is the homework and also trial and play. I have my amazing acting coach, Nancy Banks. You know, we did a lot of playing and grounding my vocal placement and even finding like, okay, like what inflection, how far do we want to go with it? And older vocal versus younger Glinda vocals. And what's the tonal shift when she's young versus when she's old? And, you know,
incredible
just
work in that regard, too. Like,
Thank you.
Have to say, one of my favorite things about the movie, just holistically, and I think it's so funny that you guys didn't chemistry test because the chemistry between you two is just nuts. And one of my favorite things about a vocal choice in that movie is that Cynthia is like singing her whole part very clean until you get that note. And it has so much gut in it.
Well, it is a war cry.
Yes. Yeah. And that like ends it. And you know that everything has changed in the way that note is sung.
Yes.
And that intentionality
is just brilliant.
Yeah.
It's so beautiful.
Yeah.
I was in the room. I got to be there.
When she actually like was doing it? Like you mean the studio?
Yeah, to hear her sing Defying Gravity. I mean, I was there when she did the rehearsal tracks.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was also on set when she was flying above me, singing.
Defying Gravity is...
You know?
You had to be there to witness it. And also just like... Because it cuts to... Not to spoil. This is not a spoiler. But it does cut to Glinda pretty frequently during that moment.
Yeah.
And I think the way, because you have an impossible thing to do in that moment, which is just to like internally project that outward as this, as everything in your world and your circumstances changing. Like even hearing you just talk about the prep and the consideration that went into this, like you have the most expansive knowledge of this character, mm-hmm. and like, thank God it's you, because you're like rising to every occasion with it. Like you rose to the audition,
thank
obviously
you.
In this such a storied way. Like I love the lore behind it now that people know about. And
thank you.
I just know, kind. Yeah, it's like, it's fucking amazing.
You know, thank that you. The movie is like about, you forget sometimes, like especially seeing it now in the way that you guys have like made it brand new, like you really remember what it's about. And it's about like speaking truth to power and how hard that is.
Yeah.
And what your character is going through, what Glinda is going through at the end of at least this movie, is she's not able to be strong enough yet to really be a face of like dissent and rebellion. Like she's seeing a truth and she's, it's like the journey that you have to go through there of like, I know what's right, but I'm just not there.
It's also like, just like a different, I think it's, I mean, yes, but also there's a different version of that, which is that she is strong enough to know that she will never choose that because she can't. She doesn't have the tools, right. And she knows what
wow,
is.
That's so interesting.
Important to her.
Yes.
And it's like, it's not that she's not ready to do that. Mm. It's just that she's not a person who's going to do that.
Oh.
And having the strength
yeah.
to know that the oh my God, annoying. Yeah. I'm so
no,
sorry.
No, I'm so curious about what you're experiencing.
No, it's just like emotional because it's like, of course it's acting and I'm not going to, you know, whatever. So you, we hit our marks and we yeah. do our thing and we sing our songs and we do what we're supposed to do. But it really felt so real. And it feels how it feels in real life when you really love someone, but the paths that you need to take for your own truth and life and who you are, it's like you can't actually, you can't actually continue growing together. You're growing apart. And you can still love that person so much and acknowledge that that's going to be best for them, but it's not going to be best for me. So I do have to not self-abandon in this moment and I have to stay where I am.
Yeah.
And I want you to go there, but I can't join you.
Wow.
So I think it's certainty. I think she's really sure in that moment. And
wow.
I think that that's strength.
Yeah.
God.
I don't think that it's that she's not strong enough to go. I think that she's strong enough to not go.
Right. Because there were... This is not to switch gears, but like there were so many moments. There was one moment, I think it was during the I've been through. It was during the I've been through scene where like we were just like ad-libbing and I forgot what I pitched you, but I was like, okay, maybe like we do our dance from school and like, I don't know, like I pitched you a line and then you looked me in the eyes and this was done in, with such love and care and respect.
What was it?
I pitched you like a stupid fucking line of like, like we do like an accent or something, and then you just look at you look me dead in the eyes and you go, I'm not gonna do that.
Did I really?
It was so funny. We were dying laughing because I was like, oh, of course. I was like, this is me playing too much with my friend.
That's
like
really
I was
funny.
Like,
I'm not gonna do
that. She's playing Glinda in the Wicked movie. I can't tell her to do bits.
Well, you can.
Yes, you can.
No, but literally,
we always tell each other what to do.
We always did that. But at that point, it was like you know, 4 months in to the
process. Do you
remember
the strawberry bush?
The strawberry bush.
What's the strawberry bush?
Broke me, and John can't find it. But I've been anxious to see it forever.
So in the scene when it's Dillman's classroom and Dillman's giving the lecture about like the history and like what happened.
And food grew scarce.
Right. He was like, food grew scarce and people were angry. And then what's the line? Like, what do people?
And people were looking for, and she's like, something to.
Someone to blame.
Yeah, someone to, and then something to whatever. But there's one about food.
There's one about, so, so he was like, the great famine occurred and, people were looking for something, and what do angry people look for? And then Elphaba says, someone to blame. But then there,
it was on
our coverage, on our coverage, it was a three shot of me, Bronwyn, and you. We did an ad lib. It was like, And because he mentions the famine, and then what do angry people do? What do angry people try to find? I'm butchering
this.
This
is terrible.
And then I go, wait,
I can't remember
I'm
the setup.
This.
No.
Literally, this is it's that just, setup.
Said, he said like a strawberry bush or something.
Strawberry
and I
bush?
Smacked him laughing. Like, I literally,
strawberry bush.
I took my paper and I smacked him with it. Because it was so good. I wish it were somewhere.
We have to find it, John.
We have to find it. The strawberry bush.
The strawberry bush was incredible. And also so was... when Nessa flies up in the sky.
God. That's my scream.
I know that's your scream. And that's your scream. And everything is flying around and things are falling and the thing falls on the ground.
And what are you doing?
Oh! So
literally, I'm like,
I know how you scream.
It was the
it's
best
so powerful.
Time.
It's so stupid.
It was the best thing ever.
Before we ask you the question that is the central question of this podcast, I also want to say one other thing, which is that the scene of the year for me is Dancing Through Life when she comes into the Ozfest ballroom.
Yeah.
And like that moment, wow. Like just... can you talk about shooting that?
Yeah.
Like, what was that experience?
Well, I mean, I love the little shot of her peeking around the corner, like, with her little hat, and she's so excited and whatever. But it's just, it's hard to describe because how it feels to watch.
Mm-hmm.
Picture that, a solid 12 hours of that.
And 4 days or something.
Yes.
Like three
that
days.
That particular
shooting.
Section, the main bulk of it was like 1.5 days.
Ugh,
but it was like 1.5 days of utter pin drop silence. And every single person in the room was absolutely just right there with Cynthia and kind of holding a very warm space, you know, for how much she was giving the whole time. And, it's such an isolating and painful scene, you know? And even if you're acting, you know, it's just like, it's such a heartbreaking feeling. And I had such flutters and butterflies that whole day. And it's just like holding space for her and then having this guilt and this realization that I'm responsible for this and just sort of like looking at a friend and trying to course correct it just so much. It was a really intense day and I feel the same feelings when I watch it back that I did in the room on the day.
It's
like
so
it's
emotional to watch.
Yeah, it was a really intense day and she's so beautiful in it. And I just remember at the end of like the 12th hour, me and Mark and John all just like took her aside and we were like, go home. And it was just a very, very, very powerful, emotional day. And she did such beautiful work and everyone just held the safest of spaces for her.
Mm.
And I like feel it when I watch it back. Certain scenes, like when they start happening, my body has like a physical reaction. When she peeks around that corner, I like get anxious for what I know is going to happen because I know how it felt on the day.
Yeah.
And I think that's a sign of what beautiful work was done because I feel like when you watch it back, you feel how it felt in the room.
And it's a wonderful reminder that you were so dropped in and present in that span of time, which was a very long time. And I say 4 days because it was like with all the Ozdust stuff.
Oh,
like
yes, with the dancing and stuff.
But
I'm talking about this part. Yes, totally. Specifically
talking
about
the,
yes.
The,
right.
the loneliness
of
that Cynthia is going through of I'm going to, you know, have this dancing moment.
That's
and everyone's watching her being like, what's happening? And it's your realization that like, this is a human being who I've hurt.
Right.
And now I'm going to show up for her. And the really wordless connection that you guys foster in that moment is so beautiful.
Thank you.
Everyone's going to love the movie so much, obviously.
She's so unfathomably spectacular
in this
film.
It's so great.
The choreography, I actually, even though we rehearsed it like once or twice before that day on set, I never learned it. Like I didn't want to remember it because I just literally wanted to be like, following her hands
learning
and like letting her lead the way.
Mm.
Because I felt like the more awkward it looks on Glinda, like, the more beautiful it can be. You know, we're both just like little, like wild deer greeting each other and trying to figure out how to speak the same language. And it's so beautifully awkward. And I love it very much.
It's very successful.
I love her very much. And yeah, it's a ride, this movie. It's going so from that into popular is such a ride. And then back again and then back again. And, you know, it's just like, it's a wild ride.
Yeah. Popular is...
Everything
you want it to be. God, you're so fucking good.
Thank you. Before we wait, can I just share one more of my favorite memories from the Ozdust Ballroom?
Yes.
Other than the fun stuff that we did, the dancing and everything in the Ozdust, we had so much fun in the Ozdust Ballroom. It really was like a week there.
It really was a week.
It was a week, yeah.
Yeah.
But what was I going to say? Oh, yes, they gave us these like universal iPhones for behind the scenes stuff. It was actually only one, and I think you and Bronwyn had it.
Bronwyn and I had it for a day, yeah, for that whole week, yeah.
And I just remember the vibe that day, and Bronwyn and you both being like, "Not the time." Because we were like, but, you know, like this is intense shit, and everyone's like, "Is like, okay, we're at the Ozdust
ballroom.
The dance is happening. Like, no, we're not." It's not the day, it's actually, the for that.
What's
like,
up, guys? This is Bowen Yang, and I'm so excited because today is the day.
Hi, J14. We're
about to group bully Cynthia Erivo for 3 days straight. I was like, are you kidding me?
They were like, are you guys getting fun stuff? And it was like, no. It was not today, in fact.
Not today. It was like universal social media people, so lovely, sweet, doing their job, like being so accommodating.
I just remember you and Bronwyn being like, Not right now.
Well, because it also is a little bit your character's, like, because your character doesn't get it. And by the way, you play a really good natural bully. You really do.
Can I say your coverage in the Ozdust? I remember I got to sit behind the monitor and watch you and Bronwyn experience that scene.
Yeah.
And it was just so beautiful. You two are so brilliantly hilarious, but also just everything was so palpable. The shift, it was so funny and so beautiful, and I have an iPhone video of that whole take if you'd like it.
Oh my God, well, because you had the iPhone.
I sure do.
That wasn't the universal
iPhone. This is my personal one. I filmed everything that happened in the whole 2 years.
It was beautiful.
Well, that was against the rules.
I understand. But I'm a very honest thief.
He sent me some videos from the set.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
Don't tell.
Can I say?
Yeah.
It's over now. What are they going to do? Edit you out?
I hope not. I perish the thought. But not to place myself in that moment, in that scene, that very intense scene, but like, I kind of feel a degree of that same thing where I watched it back and I was like, God, I feel like absolute shit. Cause even in doing it, cause acting is acting, whatever. But even in like bullying Cynthia throughout this movie, like there were so many times where I went up to her and I was like, I'm so sorry. This feels so rotted in my soul to treat you this way.
Right.
And I think it's just a testament to like the way she's being so completely raw and beautiful and vulnerable in every frame of this. And God, you're both, you couldn't ask for two better people to do this.
That's beautiful and kind.
Let's ask you the question.
Ariana Grande.
Okay, sorry.
What is the, why are you apologizing?
Because I am dilly-dally. I'm taking us miles back.
I know.
I still have so much more to say about everything.
We'll talk about it. We got to talk about Figment.
What's the one question?
The one question we have to ask you is, what was the culture that made you say culture was for you? If you can look back in your life and you think Ari Grande became Ari Grande as a result of this influence, this thing in pop culture, this moment, whatever it is, can you speak on that?
Yeah. I mean, I think musical theater.
Yeah.
Like, I think Sherry Renee Scott. Is my answer.
Love that answer.
But you
did
know
you see Aida?
I did. I mean, I loved the soundtrack. I was really little. I don't think I actually saw it.
I saw it with Toni Braxton.
But I saw, oh my God, work.
Can you believe?
No, but I saw her in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels.
Yeah.
And I remember being like, that's life-changing to see. She's the best in the world.
You look at someone doing musical theater at a level like that and you're like, oh, well, I'm watching the most talented person on earth.
Yes. I mean, her and Kristen and Sutton Foster and just these like ladies who I grew up just listening on repeat and just like my musical theater goddesses, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Does it feel right? Like, yeah, absolutely. And I guess my question for you is like, you know, I'm watching Wicked and I had that feeling of like, well, she needs to act more.
That's sweet.
But then also at the same time, it's like, you are probably the most like, just important, gifted, like relevant pop artist.
No.
But let me say it because I believe it. And then you're like, does Broadway fit into that? Like, is it something that would make sense for you? And is it in your heart to actually go to the stage and do that?
It is my heart. You know, it is like, I'm going to say something so scary. It's going to scare the absolute shit out of my fans and everyone. But I love them and they'll deal and we'll be here forever. I'm always going to make music. I'm always going to go on stage. I'm always going to do pop stuff. I pinky promise. But I don't think doing it at the rate that I've been doing it for the past 10 years is where I see the next 10 years.
Good for you.
I think I love acting. I love musical theater. I think reconnecting with this part of myself who started in musical theater and who loves comedy, and it heals me to do that, finding roles to use these parts of myself, you know, and put them in little homes and characters and bits and voices
you.
And songs. Like, it really does in a different way than songwriting and writing about my own pain, because it's just kind of like constantly reliving that one thing that you wrote the song about or that is, you know, and finding a character and putting the pieces there, finding channeling little homes for them there, and then them coming back and feeding you and teaching you new things through performing the act of being Glinda, you know, and taking pieces from her back, it really feeds you.
Yeah.
And I think that I would love to in whatever makes sense or whatever roles that we see fit or where I could really do a good job or honor the material, I would really love to, because I think it's a lot better for me.
Yeah.
I hear you, especially
I'm getting emotional.
Because I've been listening to, I will listen to you all the time, but like so many of my favorite songs of yours, I can tell are unbearable for you to put out there. Like I listen to, I won't even say the song title.
No, okay, my God, dude, I'm fine.
Mean, imagine. I mean, I wish I hated you. Like I had such an experience. And I have my own theories about like what We Can't Be Friends is, but I think the video like is something that spoke to, I know me personally and so many people in such a visceral way. And there's that moment in the video, which by the way, is the video of the year, and everyone knows it.
Thank you.
So there's that moment where you hesitate in the process of having your memories removed and it's like, I don't want to let go. I'm actually uneasy. Like maybe my pain is really important. And if I lose that, like, where am I going next? Like, it's scary. And I think that that's such a specific thing to get across, but like has to be painful to literally fixate on the idea of eternal sunshine.
Right.
Because the idea is that we feel this way. We want to create something called eternal sunshine because we're fixating on wanting to remove those emotions.
Right.
And yet here we are literally performing them. And I think that you're so sensitive and such a, you know, what you could say cancer vibes or whatever, but like you're so in tune to your work and you're so giving of yourself that it has to feel fucking exhausting. And so if you have other talents and other like interests, I get that. I love you back.
That was such a thoughtful parade of like thoughtfulness. I love you. Thanks.
Yeah, I hear you.
He's good at that. He's good at the thoughtful parade of thoughtfulness.
Well, I mean, I don't know.
Good job at talking, Ariana.
No, that's not me. I guess what I'm saying is like, I'm not even asking you a question. I guess I'm just acknowledging and seeing, and I want you to know that as your fan, like, we just want you to feed yourself and do what makes you feel good and evolve.
I love you.
And you
That's
are
so
evolving.
Kind.
Like in this movie, like I'm telling you, like now am I gonna cry? Like I just feel like it's so amazing to see someone do something they were born to do. Like, and I don't know, I've always felt like, especially because you've been such a good sister to my sister, like I just like want you to be happy and I root for you.
Oh my God.
I'm sorry.
Man, oh my God, are you okay?
I feel, you know, you're just, but this is like what you do. You're such an available, open, and emotional person, and I
deeply.
We're so far away. That was weird, but I know, but thank you for taking the risk.
By the way, you yanked her down.
Also, I think
floor.
My chair is like cemented to the ground.
No.
Okay.
That just reminded me of when I did Celebrity Wheel of Fortune with Paula Abdul. She's so small that she would do the wheel and the wheel would take her. So it was like she's in the middle and like I'm here, like this is Paula. She goes, "All right, here we go." And like threw away and like her leg went up. She was a good sport about it.
Can I just thank you for saying that just because it was so incredibly kind and I really appreciate it and I am going to carry it with me because I really appreciate it and I am very thankful and it was really kind and generous and I appreciate it and it's nice to hear. But art also is what feeds me.
Of course.
So in whatever capacity it is, mm-hmm. I'll always be doing and creating 6 different things at once. You know what I mean? It's just, I don't see that going anywhere. I just see it kind of like shifting and becoming a little different.
Write chapters. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like there's like, I'm thankful to you for Positions because
Thank
that
you.
Was my fucking fuck album for the pandemic. And I'll look you
good.
In the eyes and say,
oh my God.
I'm telling you, there's not a better piece. Like, thank you for R&B
oh, cool.
pop.
Thank you.
She can't handle that part. We can be locked in.
I opened my mouth too much.
But like, yeah,
you really
I mean,
didn't. It was beautiful. The characters needed it. But yeah,
yes.
thank you. That's such a funny thing. But the life cycle that album has taken because when,
yeah,
pardon me, sorry. No. But when it came out, it was kind of like.
Bizarre.
It didn't go so well.
Did it feel like it came out in a soft way, whereas Thank You, Next and Sweeter had been such moments? Or do you care about that?
No. Not even like that. I just mean as far as like what my fans were saying and like as far as whatever.
Like they were
I feel
not...
like in the beginning of the Positions of it all, like it kind of was, I got a little, I'm not going to like use this word as a bully, but you know.
Yeah, I hear
I just
you.
Got like a little bit of... this is not what we want vibes, I think.
Oh.
And I remember that really, I'm such a sensitive artist, but whatever.
Yeah.
This is the point. You put art there so that people can tear it apart and do whatever they want with it or celebrate it or whatever. I understand. I'm very grateful in an acceptance to be here. When I preface this, I need to preface it with that because I know it comes with being an artist. But I also am a Cancer and very sensitive. So I just remember that really like, put me in a cage of like judging every single piece. I like scrapped so many things that I was like gonna put out for it. And now people are just, they love it like it's the best thing I'll ever make. And I'm like, what is that? I'm like, how is that fair?
It takes people time sometimes, especially when they really get worked up in their heads that we're gonna get a certain thing and then it's a little different.
But
I
love
like,
them for it and it's okay
totally.
And it's fine. And it's not mine anymore. And that's the thing that I also have to say because I am aware. It's like a part of it. And I'm grateful for the voices and for the passion.
Right.
I am. I really am.
You released it.
But I'm
and
also
then,
a person.
Of course. And so this is what makes you a true realized artist is that you are incredibly emotionally intelligent. You're, I think, EQ, you're... Like, I think you're the highest EQ
Einstein
person.
EQ, period.
That is, wow.
But I think that, like, every artist, not every artist, but, like, it kind of is this fun little jewel now on every artist's, like, crown where it's like, oh, you put out a body of work that ends up being, at the time, mischaracterized or misinterpreted. And then over time, it develops the patina and people are like, oh my God, this was always great.
It's strange to watch happen. It's
totally.
Kind of interesting.
But I feel like with what you're saying about being an artist, like, I mean, we've had conversations about this, especially when Eternal Sunshine came out. We're like, God, this is really, everything is so considered. And I was even watching you do your makeup video for The Boy's Mind. And I'm like,
oh, right.
And I want it. This is the stupidest question. But I have to ask you.
Okay.
It's not. Because,
he does.
Because you're so good at makeup, do you have an interest or have you explored drawing? Do you know what I mean? Like, you're so dexterous with your, like you're able to, no, look at me.
Bowen, I'm not dexterous.
What if we have crayons and we're just like,
could you draw?
Would you consider
drawing us a picture?
Painting me today. He brings out an easel and some oil paint.
I paint
with my dad sometimes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
We do like little like paint and sips sometimes.
Oh, that's so really cute.
They like watercolors. And I painted for Cynthia, actually. I painted a cute little thing of Munchkinland. And it's like the tulips with the yellow brick road up the middle. And then there's a little bubble in the sky. And there's a green like cloudy behind it. Uh-huh. And a little tiny little Elfie and the monkeys behind.
Oh, cute.
So I painted that for her. But I don't have that much time to color or paint. So I don't. But I love to. And I'm very creative. My dad is like an artist in every way. Yeah. Graphic designer, photographer,
really?
Painter. Yes. And he's super creative in that way. And I that's so nice. No one's ever talked to me about painting, but coloring before.
Right, but I'm saying, like, it makes sense to me. Like, you're so
coloring's
precise
amazing.
With the hand.
Coloring's amazing. I love a coloring book. I love a coloring book, especially, like, when it's a funny concept. Like,
I
it's
just bought
like,
the one of Oz for Cynthia.
Oh, that's great.
Yes.
Mm. And the thing is,
my
what
mom.
Was the way I said that? And the thing is that in when you get, like, a wicked coloring book, like, you kind of think like, oh, I know what everything should be. And so then you just do it your own way. Suddenly, Elphaba is not green. She's purple. Think about that for once.
But my mom recently was like, oh, is that a coloring book? It was that she came over and I was like,
I haven't seen one in a long time.
She was like, and she self-proclaims, yeah, I haven't seen one of those.
I haven't seen one of those in
a while. Uh-huh. But no, she says she's not like creative and that she doesn't like things like that, but she loves it. Uh-huh. And I was like, mommy, you don't need to be, you know, creative. She's a business brilliant person, but she, you know, she, I gave her the colored pencils and the coloring book and she loved it.
Yeah.
But also picture the character from SNL and she was coloring so hard. She was like, I love this. And I was like, mommy.
That was based in reality?
Like, oh, yes. So wait, should we
talk
about this?
Talk about the origin story of that.
So this is why, like, you should not apologize for, like you did not text me a bunch before in the lead-up. Like, this is, thank God you did, because, like, literally, like,
we're helping write
well,
the piece.
This happened.
2 months before the show, before you came on.
Like, yeah, it was Labor Day weekend, and my brother-in-law Hale's family was visiting, and we had a lovely, fun game day, and it was so fun and funny and sweet. And my mom is, by the way, the most generous, kindest, giving person in the entire world.
Yes.
She is like
good
the
preface.
Hostess with the mostest.
Right.
You will walk in and there are like a million fruit trays and vegan options.
She's
for the
John
vegan
Grande.
People. The vegan people being me and Hale only.
Yeah, yeah.
And but even that, just there's like, you know, she wants to take everyone everywhere and she's just the best. Yeah. She's the kindest, most generous person in the entire world. Mm. And, but.
Competitive.
Yeah.
Ooh.
And fiercely protective of her children. Yeah.
I see.
So even if we're playing, you know, charades and whatever, you don't fuck around. So this is what happened. And I excused myself immediately to send a voice note to Bowen. I said, okay, well,
there is something brewing here.
There's
could
something
be something.
Here. Yeah, so we were playing charades. And Hill's brother, my brother-in-law's brother, who I love, they're all so sweet, they're amazing, was like, ha-ha, like, we're winning vibes. Like, that was
yeah,
the extent
like,
of it. Was like, he was like, hoo-hoo, we're ahead.
Throwing it back.
We're ahead.
Yeah.
And my mom goes, tiny dick syndrome, huh? And I was like this.
Mommy.
Tiny dick syndrome, huh?
Mommy, wait, like, that's not funny. I was like, Mom, that's intense and harmful.
Knee-jerk.
That's like so intense. And we all were laughing. And of course, like, he laughed and everyone was laughing. Uh-huh. But she was like, well, that's a sign of what that is. And I was like, Mommy. This is insane. And then I started doing it as a bit for Jesse, Hill's other brother.
Yeah.
And he was crying tears. tears, and like it lasted the whole day. So I was like, it. Bowen, we have to do something with this, please. It's just so silly.
And my jaw dropped. I was like, Joan.
Yeah. And yeah. And also we have like a very aggressive game playing family too. I'm like the opposite. So where my mom and Frankie and Hale sit on the spectrum of, I'm an alien in my family a little bit because I'm like, I don't care. I just want to have fun and I want to be there and I'm here for a good time.
Gotcha.
You know, I'm okay. I just want to play the game. I'm happy to be there. I don't even know half the rules. I'm
like
just
winning is not your culture.
No, no,
being
no.
Here, participation. Being here is a great time. Yeah. And I miss everyone when I'm not home and you know, this is a great time.
Yeah.
Not for Hale or Frankie or my mom. It is real. It's real deal.
You're and right.
Hale's a real gamer, though. He knows games that no one's ever heard of in the history of the world. He's like a genius nerd person who loves games. And Frankie can't lose a game. Mommy can't lose a game.
Because you know what? First of all,
they can't lose a game.
Ari's vibe on Jackbox
they don't
is
like it.
A++++.
I love Jackbox. We need to
you
shred.
Have to do,
we need
to play. Please.
Yeah, that's what we need to do.
We need to do that.
Okay.
We need to do.
Jackbox, we need to get
Josh and Aaron to do Jackbox.
See, this is this. I see it in my mind.
I love them. I love your whole
they're the best.
Group.
They're the best. They are really, truly are the funniest. Have you seen fucking Identical Twins?
I watched Dicks.
Or Dicks.
We watched Dicks.
Yeah,
together.
We watched Dicks together. It was, I mean, I'm obsessed with them. Yeah, they're angels from heaven.
Yeah, that's like a truly fun game too, because really who cares if you win? Like it's fun if you win, but it's really more just about making each
giggles.
Other laugh.
Giggles, yeah. But it's about laughter.
Frankie was about the points. It's always about the points.
He is about the points too. It was so funny.
You know what that might be though? Because I also am like the youngest. I'm the oldest and I'm a gay son. So there's that little bit thing of like best little boy in the world. I'm going to win the game because like, you know what I'm saying? Is that might be a thing. Because you're not really competitive need to win.
No, never.
You're really not.
Can we, wait, sorry. I'm sorry. But speaking of Frankie, can we go see Rocky Horror while it's still happening, please?
How longer is it happening? How longer is it happening?
I don't know, actually.
We'll go.
Tonight. That's
God,
it.
You know what I'm seeing tonight? Cabaret.
Oh my God.
I'm seeing Marty in Cabaret.
Really? I'm so jealous.
I know. I saw it in the West End with Jake Shears.
Oh, great.
And it was great. And I'm seeing it again. I haven't seen it yet in New York. I love Cabaret. It's one of my favorite shows.
Are you coming to the screening tonight?
I wasn't told the details. And so I wasn't planning. I would love to.
I'll tell you the details.
Okay. Yeah.
Well,
I was
going to
take a date to it tonight and he's going to this that you're talking about.
The date that date?
I was... So I'm you guys, that's actually going to be really fun because it's going to be all the Broadway people.
But I wish I could
seeing it.
Be coming with you. We wish we could do both at the same time.
Know.
I want to see Marty and Cabaret.
They're my favorite MC. Mm.
Really?
And
love that. I cannot wait.
What a beautiful person inside and out.
Oh, absolutely. Good vibe.
Absolutely.
Isn't it great when like, because you're like a Drag Race fan.
Yes.
You watch every season?
I watch almost every, I mean, I try to. Mm-hmm. I'm a big Drag Race fan.
Have you been judged twice or once?
Twice. Season 7.
Because I remember season 7, iconically, that was a really amazing episode. The first time you were there, and they did Break Free at the end.
I wish I remembered more of that experience.
It's okay.
You
it
were great,
a long time ago.
And they did Break Free, and it was Candy Ho versus Mama Who Won.
And
not who won the show, but won the lip sync. I'm forgetting her name.
Jaden Dewar Fierce.
Yes, Jaden Dewar Fierce.
Yeah, that was crazily the morning after we shot the Bang Bang video. And I had no sleep and I came straight there and it was like a full 12-hour
full
day.
It's a surreal thing
really
to
crazy.
Be. When we were there, we also had a really good episode.
We had
actually.
A great episode, but those were long days.
Your episode? Oh my God, yeah. No, it was beautiful.
That was fun. We got Hallucinate by Dua was the lip sync and we are screaming the whole time. When they cut to us and we are...
Living
the fantasy because it was Jasmine Kennedy.
Of course.
That was really the ripping it up.
That was a great, great, great episode. We'll figure it out. We'll go see it. Okay, so Marty, wait, hold on. We need to talk about something before we go move on to I Don't Think So, Honey. And then
I can't even believe we're going to move on. Why could this?
I
this
don't
should go
move
on for
on.
Six more hours.
I know.
Where's
Can
the
we
team?
Do like a little more? What's
of course.
In the sea? Hold on.
No one has to be anywhere.
It's 2:20. No one has to be anywhere.
You sure?
No, I'm
Are you
okay.
sure? Because this isn't like a press day for you, or is it?
This is a press day for me, but this is the most important part.
What else are you doing?
I do have to leave at 3. That's perfect.
Okay, no problem.
No,
you hear that?
It's 2:20. If I can leave by 3, we're good. I'll be
no
completely
problem.
Early and on time.
You know what else you need to go see? And you need to go see. What you need to go see is Sunset Boulevard with Nicole.
I know. I mean, that's everything I could want for a person.
You
I love
what?
This moment for her
yes.
so much. She is so in her element, so dropped in, so beautiful, so fucking talented.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I love that. The pictures of her in blood at the stage door.
It's iconic.
That's
iconic.
Me. That's a mood. That's a mood.
But Nicole, I love watching someone.
She's
it's
so
like,
brilliant.
It's like seeing you in the Wicked movie. It's like when you watch someone
and you go,
get
oh,
the opportunity.
That's where they're supposed to be. Yes. How beautiful that it's happening.
And I'm telling you right now, I was at the opening night of Sunset Boulevard. I sat next to Candy Burris.
Oh my God.
The legend. Like literally star-studded. So many people there, like sitting there watching her. And I thought, wow, she is stepping into destiny right now.
Yeah.
She's giving one of those performances everyone
chills,
will always talk about. And it is amazing.
Yeah, it's beautiful to see, even like from afar, as a person who hasn't even seen it yet. I'm like, oh, I know exactly what's coming.
Yep. We need to talk about Figment.
Oh, let's
we
let's
do
get
need to talk
it.
About Figment.
So this is also another moment where I was like,
oh, we're supposed to be in each other's lives.
We're supposed
forever.
To be in each other's lives. And I was, and then I also thought, and I did I not tell you, I was like, you need to meet my friend Matt Rogers.
Yeah. That was actually the moment.
That was
we
the
need
moment.
To go to Disney together.
Absolutely. There. Absolutely. Which where, one? Which one? Florida?
I mean,
or
I'm an Orlando girly.
Okay.
I mean, I'm connected.
Me too.
To...
Me too. We share that.
Yeah.
Yes.
We share that.
I mean, okay.
And also, it's where the Tower of Terror remains.
100%. And can you speak on this? Because this is really important because, you know,
Figment.
This came up with Mariah.
We mentioned you on the Mariah episode.
And speak on Tower of Terror. Speak on Disney.
Whoa. Okay. I want to speak on the Tower of Terror.
Yes.
Start there.
Because I love and I respect
Guardians.
The Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, we...
Of course
we
I do.
See
I think
her.
It's a beautiful...
Experience.
A beautiful thing.
Love
it's
that
a
little
great,
raccoon.
It's impressive.
Love
it's
it.
Amazing. I'm like a big Baby Groot person.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love it.
Really cool. I don't remember, you know, much about her, but I love her.
Yeah.
Yes.
And... I just think that it is so...
That was a zipper. That was not a fart. I'm sorry.
There was a noise over... There was a noise down here, which could have gone either way.
No.
But I have to tell you.
Sorry.
It had to be called
out. No.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, please. The space is yours. I'm in your home.
No, and you're literally about to like meditate on Tower of Terror.
No, please. Honestly, I'm glad that happened because something needed to break the tension of what I was feeling inside.
You felt tense?
About the Tower of Terror.
You're angsty about this because you
I'm
feel
not
it's
angsty,
an... No, you're, it's an endangered species.
It's not angst. It's... it's dire desperation.
Yeah,
real desperation.
Existential.
To protect and preserve what is the Tower of Terror.
Yeah, I believe it should be a historical landmark.
Absolutely, and I think it's really important and great that there is the Guardians of the Galaxy ride in California.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's perfect. And, you know, Aurora's Castle, keep it, all of that's great. And I love that that's the first and it's there.
Yeah.
When it comes to Florida, mm-hmm. when it comes to the Disney in Florida,
don't do it.
First of all, we get Cinderella's castle, which is, you know,
so cunty.
Also a landmark.
She's large and in charge.
Yes, she is.
Mm?
My mom tells us too often that she wants her ashes sprinkled over it. And I'm like, Mom, it's Christmas. Do we have to talk about this right now? And she's like, yeah, you have to make sure that that happens. And I'm like, Mom, I don't want to make sure that that happens.
Well,
also, like, I think that's like, I think there's like actors back there working. And so you're going to be sprinkled on people's heads who are like dressed as Tinkerbell waiting for their cue.
Totally. There's like a hotel room in there.
Yeah,
the
absolutely. There's lots happening back there. That
I've
don't
heard
think
it's kind of small.
Right.
I've heard the like what you think the experience of staying in that.
I've
hotel
been in
room.
There.
Have you?
I've been in there because I performed at the castle one
that's
time
right.
and I got to change in there,
oh!
which was really cool.
Yes.
And it's really beautiful. And it's really, it feels very real.
Do you have a Club 33 membership?
I don't.
But you've been in.
I've been there.
Yeah.
I've been through.
I've been through.
I've been through. But yeah.
Okay,
Feels a little extreme to me.
Yeah, sure.
To have that.
What, the 30-year
do
wait?
Do you have
I've
it?
I've somehow gotten in
but
like
do you have
three
a thing?
Times. No.
Okay, no. It
but
feels
I,
like a lot.
I am like the kind of mental illness where it's like, I will one day.
Sure.
Like I have a sick disease that no one can figure out what it is where like I will go there. I'll something happens to me when
if
I go
do
there.
If you do it, I'll do it.
Okay, let's do it.
I'm in.
We'll get on the list. Hey, put us on the list.
Yeah.
Whoever the powers that be.
Yeah, put us on the list.
And we have to make that happen.
Yes, absolutely. Keep talking.
No, I just think it's really, I think it's actually one of the most important things.
It's art.
That it's day.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Did you ever tell Ari about when we had to be evacuated?
It broke on us.
The tower?
It
we
literally.
We were on a metric ton of edible what did we do?
The
Rice Krispie treats.
Edible Rice Krispies.
Oh my goodness. And it broke down?
and it broke down, not like as you're about to go in.
When she goes forward.
When she goes forward.
Right.
It broke down.
That's so scary.
And we were stoned out of our gourd being like, yo, is this happening?
Honestly, it was
that's
like,
not fair.
It was the kind of thing where it
that's
was like,
not
we,
good.
We were no. between worlds.
Right, right, right.
While we were like between worlds. And so what they ended up doing was someone kind of comes in out of the shadows.
Out of the proscenium.
And goes, need to get up.
How do they
out.
Get up? Wait, how do they get in there?
Stairs.
Whoa.
So, and I hate an illusion being shattered.
I know.
But it was kind of fascinating. Because they go, you guys need to get up, walk into the Twilight Zone, and step out through the exit door.
Oh,
exit door.
No.
Take a real elevator down.
So, I don't want to know where the exit door is.
We're not going to tell
don't
you, but
tell
isn't
me.
That crazy?
That's really crazy. I'm so glad that you're safe and that it was fine.
We're okay.
I hope one day you experience this.
I don't want to know where the exit is.
Oh.
I don't like when any ride breaks down. I mean, like breaking news.
Yes.
Have you been down there to do the Guardians roller coaster in Epcot?
Amazing.
Another
Amazing.
Piece of art.
That's what it should be.
Yes.
Glenn Close.
That's yes. what it should be.
Glenn
That's
Close.
Incredible. Yes. And the music is different every time.
Yes.
And it's just fabulous.
When Conga plays.
Crazy.
Crazy.
It goes crazy.
Absolutely so glad you brought that up because I was going to bring it up.
Oh, this was funny. So we ended up going a bunch of times and I was like, God, I wish it was Conga. And they go, they say that it's going to happen in two things and they can put you on the train for Conga. And we did it, and it was the best. And then what was it that you wanted?
I really wanted Tears for Fears. Everybody wants to rule the world.
Right.
And we never got it.
They couldn't figure That's it okay. out for Bowen.
No problem.
Oh, my.
And it.
Well, we'll have to go again.
We'll have to go again. On set on Wicked, there is a sculpted sort of thing, a gigantic sculpted...
Jeff Goldblum.
A thing of Jeff Goldblum as the wizard.
Wait, do you remember when we discovered his head? And we didn't know about
it? We didn't know. And then
I
remember. I have pictures of it.
Yeah, because we were going for a walk.
We were going for a walk.
Talking about life.
And then
you must.
We happen upon this gigantic face of
Jeff
Goldblum. Jeff
Goldblum's face. And we were like, dear God. Oh my goodness, Jeff.
Oh my God.
Basically a two-story tall sculpted face mask of Jeff Goldblum. And we're like, wow, this is crazy. And then it's in the movie. It serves a purpose.
Yes, it serves a beautiful purpose. But we just had no idea. We were so disarmed by it.
Yes.
Figment.
Was this Figment?
No, this Figment.
But in a way, one day we were on set.
We were on set and we
and
were
I
just...
Was, and we were just like...
Talking about our favorite... Talking about characters, our favorite Disney
right?
ride.
You said
Disney,
you love
underrated,
Figment.
Underrated.
Journey into the Imagination.
Yes, because we were like, oh my gosh. Like, oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh. We had said, oh my gosh. You know who I love? That Figment.
That Figment
my
guy.
Gush.
No, get up, girl. Diva down.
Wait, no. Here's an actual question I need answered absolutely right now. If they were to add one of your songs to Guardians of the Galaxy.
They don't have to do that.
Because I want it.
No, don't
Why
make her.
Is it
don't
into
make her.
You? Why
don't.
Is it into you? Can you imagine? So like, I would be gagging.
You're like, I would love I to ride would... the Ghostin Guardians of the Galaxy version.
Ghostin? No!
It's like, I can be needy.
No, not Ghostin.
Wait, I listened to Needy this morning and I said, why is this me? And I love that, just to speak on that, like, I love Needy going into NASA. I was watching for some reason. Sometimes, as I want to do, I'll watch like old clips of The Voice.
Yeah.
Would you ever go back and do that again? And do you think you mostly did it because the chair spun?
So, no, but it was a perk.
It was a perk.
It was a good perk.
The theme park thing of this.
Yes, is so
fun.
Crazy.
It feels really fun to me.
It is really fun.
Clearly to you too.
You have to go do it at some point.
I would love to hit the button.
It's really fun.
Yeah.
It's really fun. I got so emotionally attached to everyone.
Did
That's
you?
My problem. I can't really do that
because
I
like, if
really
you back,
get in. Yeah. I really get in there with everyone. And I love everyone so much. I love meeting people and I felt so invested.
Yeah.
And I still do. Like I see them all
do
on Instagram.
You, do you
and I'm
keep
like,
in touch with?
Yes. I mean, not, I've been in busy. I haven't really been
of
in touch
course.
With anyone, but I love them and I'm in touch with them on Instagram. Like I like their posts, I see their things, I see what they're up to. Bella had a baby.
Aww.
Sasha's putting out solo music. Sasha of Jim and Sasha.
Incredible.
And you know, I mean, like he sent me his project last year and he's so talented.
Yeah.
And so I'm still in touch with some of them, but it's just like I get very involved.
Yeah, and also, like, for a non-competitive person, like, the rest of those judges were really competitive. Like, Kelly is really competitive. Yeah.
I love her.
She's the number one.
That is, so she's the best in the world.
The queen.
Is she the best singer in the world? Like,
she's
incredible. It could be
Kelly Clarkson.
Yeah, it could be a thing. Yeah.
She's unbelievable.
Just wild.
She really is one of the greatest vocalists that there ever has been ever.
So, were you being, like, you know, like, young when she was on American Idol, was that like a trip for you? Like, I wonder, like, when you meet these people that are, like, you know, now your peers,
right,
or now these,
or,
like,
gosh,
well, it feels probably odd to say
it feels crazy.
You, as someone who's, like, a really reverent, like, respecter of these vocal legends,
good,
like,
vocals,
now to hear them, mm-hmm, just to be able to engage with them, like,
right,
how do you approach that?
I mean, so many things that have come to be in my life feel, yeah, like such a dream. Like, yeah, I can't really fathom a lot of things, you know, even getting to know Imogen Heap,
yeah,
you know, just kind of meeting her was one of the best things that has ever happened ever. You know, I was so in shock and all. The first time I went to go meet her, I thought it was being catfished.
Wow.
I didn't really think it was going to be her.
Yeah.
I was really scared. And then I got kind of like lost in the woods and I was like, this is it.
Yeah, this
I'm
is
done.
It.
It was in the woods.
I mean, well, the journey there.
Oh,
yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm not going to like give, I'm not going to like drop a
it was
pin.
In the woods.
I'm not going to like drop a location.
She said,
know,
meet me.
In Emmy's house.
She's like, I'm in the Poconos.
No, but it really is a trip.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah.
I just feel so deeply grateful because so much of the art that I have loved,
yeah,
I've developed an interesting relationship with, or artists that I've loved. And, you know, when they say, don't meet your idols, I've had so many positive experiences of that. And I'm so grateful for that, you know?
Can I share what the moment was that I got to witness of you meeting Stevie Nicks?
Yeah.
It was for promos on Thursday. And
she had written me a letter a few years ago. So we had spoken.
You'd been in contact.
We had spoken once before, but we had never met. But sorry to interrupt.
No. And Ari and I were already on the floor, just like giggling, being stupid. And then they bring Stevie on, and I just kind of immediately knew to back away.
No.
Stevie took Ari's hands and was like, I have to tell you that I loved your video for We Can't Be Friends. It reminded me of so many,
yeah,
people that I have come across in my life.
Probably and brought Lindsay Buckingham up.
Sure, totally. And like, and that's if for whatever the song means, like for her to...
That was such a surreal moment.
I couldn't believe it.
I couldn't
it.
Believe anything. She's so kind.
So kind.
And so cool and so beautiful. I can't really get over what that was like, spending those few days together and sharing a space with her. Just such a warm, beautiful, good witch in every sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
And just overly generous, like,
yeah,
overly friendly, overly kind. And I don't know. I feel like I love meeting people and talking, but sometimes I can go and overstay my welcome. I feel it. And I felt like I wasn't doing that. She just wanted to keep going with me.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my goodness, we're both going and going and going.
Yeah.
And she's such a sweet, kind energy. And I just, I couldn't wrap my head around it.
What she's offering right now too with this new song. Like I was watching an interview with her a couple days ago and, you know, the song is about like women like acting right now and like, you know,
fighting
us voting and fighting the fight, like, and really making sure that we don't lose rights. But she was really talking about it in a way of like service.
Mm-hmm.
She's
right.
Like, she said this line in this interview where she was like, I was given this gift and I'm doing my job.
Right.
She's like, I'm out here. And you get the sense that it's just like, you know, she didn't have to do Saturday Night Live.
No.
You know what I mean? I would imagine that's a pretty daunting thing to be asked. And she spoke on how nervous she was. But you get the sense that she's like, no, I'm
people
being
need
given
to hear
this
song.
I'm being given this opportunity. I have this to offer. And she kept saying like, you know, I tell a good story. So I'm going to go out there and tell the story.
Wow.
And it was just like, there was like a selfless, like artist mentality that she so clearly had and has had.
There's work to be done and I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
She's unbelievable. Yeah.
There's a serviceability in what she does that she knows about. You know, she's like, I'm going to like be the vehicle for this message. That's, God, I just love her. I loved seeing you guys together. That was really
fun. It felt
fun.
Really special.
Yeah.
The BTS.
That felt like
because I remember we got to be on the floor for Edge of 17. And so there was a moment where, for some reason, they had to hold it back for a second. Like, I guess maybe some commercial was going too long or whatever. And there was a moment, but there, I was watching you guys interact with each other and like have a moment of play in that moment. And I was like, this is very, it's like a, obviously a cool live TV moment, like where they get to count down a few different times. Mm-hmm. But just watching you guys together was a really fun.
It was really BTS sweet. Moment. We both kind of looked at each other. We were like,
Yeah.
And it was very sweet.
Yeah.
And, you know, when live things like that are happening, it's everyone gets a little like nervous, and we felt like the audience get a little tense too. So we started doing like a bit with them too.
Uh-huh.
It was really fun.
You could play her in a biopic.
Oh, my.
If that, if, like, that not to be like, that should happen in the way that, but you could.
Oh my goodness. There are so many girlies that would be perfect for that.
Well, I'm just saying. Just, you know, maybe one of the girlies.
Stevie should play Stevie.
There you go.
No one can do Stevie better.
Exactly. It's like when Fantasia played herself.
Absolutely.
Remember that? It was years ago. Fantasia played herself in her own biopic for Lifetime.
Yes.
Yes.
Genius.
Yeah.
Should happen more.
Do you remember when Cher played everyone in
West Side Story?
West Side Story.
Yeah.
Iconic.
Fabulous.
You could pull that off.
That's really fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to know what that meeting was.
You think it was just one meeting?
Yeah, I do.
With our final 20 minutes, let's cross into I Don't Think So Honey, because I Don't Think So Honey always provokes conversation, and I want to leave room for it. So I Don't Think So Honey is our 60-second segment where we all rant, rail, and rave against something in culture that just bothers us.
Mm-hmm.
And we it's a cathartic moment, and we're all going to be made better for it. I have something that I'd like to do.
Okay.
I don't really have, like, I haven't planned anything out. I just have my emotions on this thing.
Okay, that's good. This is Matt Rogers. I Don't Think So Honey. His time starts now.
I Don't Think So Honey calamari. Can I ask you a genuine question? Who actually cares?
I do.
You actually care about calamari. You think that you... I Don't Think So Honey that it's ever different one place to the other. Don't get me wrong. It's a really good appetizer.
Mm-hmm.
There's no versatility. And if you get into being versatile with your calamari, what's going to happen is it's not fried. Then it's just like, what? Boiled calamari?
Sure.
I'm sorry, but
I'm vegan.
It's boring. It's boring. The things we can do with other appetizers. Look at my girl wings.
Oh.
You can have her lemon pepper. You can have her buffalo. You can have her barbecue. And I've only listed three. I don't have time to list the rest. But what I'm saying is the versatility. Now, I hear you at home. Matt, what about buffalo calamari? You have a point.
15 seconds.
But you don't see it. You don't hear about it. Calamari feels like something that's on the table constantly. And I'm like, that's great, but are we just not using our imaginations?
Put
Brussels sprouts on the table as an appetizer. I'm saying it, and Bahid is nodding. And I want to say, Bahid, let's get more creative with appetizers. Seafood restaurants, I'm looking at you. Like, come on, let's get the raw bar together.
That's quite enough. That's 1 minute.
All right.
Wow.
I just feel...
Do you feel better?
I don't think anyone agrees with me.
See?
I agree. I don't think... I mean, but I also have never had it. I don't want to eat them.
You don't want to eat them.
I don't want to eat them.
I gotta
say, I think it's better for the world.
Yeah, I hear that deeply.
But to each their own.
To each their own. Because you're right, it is better for the world. I mean, when Natalie Portman came out with that documentary, that was, did you ever watch her doc?
No.
Eating Animals,
it was what it was called. And it was so crazy to watch her do press for it, because she was like, listen, my documentary does talk about how it's much, much better for the world for us to not do it, but I'm not telling you not to. I'm just here with my documentary.
Yeah.
And like, watch it or don't. This is the choice I made for myself, but
she's like, it's not that you're wrong, I'm just right.
Yeah. It's not that you're wrong, I'm just right, was really the vibe.
Which is a vibe.
Yeah.
Two things can be true.
For me, yeah, two things can be true.
It's not that you're wrong, I'm just right.
Right, absolutely.
I'm right, and... you might be wrong.
I'm big and you're small.
What's that from?
Trunchbull.
Oh, Matilda.
Say the legend's name, Trunchbull.
Trunchbull.
I have a question.
Yes.
Yeah.
Should my thing be about the Tower of Terror?
Absolutely.
Should I read my thing?
Yes.
Hold on, I have to get it.
Do you want
to
go and then?
I'll go. I do want to say, I want to push back and say that you cannot say that anyone who likes calamari is unimaginative when it comes to appetizers. I just think that
you don't like it.
All the sauces you named for wings can easily be slathered onto
But you don't talk about it like that.
I'm just offering up my rebuttal. That's all.
You are a calamari queen.
I love calamari.
Have you ever watched the, like, My Best Friend the Octopus?
Yes.
Oh, My Octopus Teacher.
My Octopus Teacher. That's what it's called.
That's a movie good for job. Dads, for sure. My dad loves that show.
For dads and me.
Yeah. And dads and Ari.
You know what I've seen, like, four times? Blackfish.
Yeah, that's a doozy. That
is, and I stay watching
it. Doesn't it stay with you after one?
I have a mental illness that no one can tell me what it is, the things I do sometimes.
Oh, Twitter will tell you.
Oh,
they'll
my
tell you.
I know they will.
Oh, come on.
Oh, they. Come the one, on. One day they all came for me. They were like, Matt has ADHD. And I was like, stop. And then I was, now I'm like, I do.
Absolutely.
No,
yeah.
You cannot.
They tell me I have a lot of things.
God.
And guys, you know, stop. You're on to something. No, I'm kidding. I'm joking. Shut you're actually down. Invasive and scary.
I'm right. I put my glass on. I look at the computer. I'm like, what do they say I have? I write that down. That down. Yeah. That down.
God.
No. Imagine. Just wrong and loud and unhealthy.
Wrong and loud.
Yeah.
That's
wrong
it.
And loud.
That's toxic.
You ready to be right and loud? With
yeah.
Your, I don't think so, honey.
Yeah.
So here comes Bowen Yang. Flat. By the way, I was showing Ari the intermediate Mariah playlist. Very this good is good
needs
stuff.
To send that to me.
Yeah, yes. I will.
That's a good one.
Okay, so Bowen Yang. Locked, loaded, ready to rip, roar, and ride. I don't think so, honey. Time starts now.
I don't think so, honey. Ginger. I don't like the way you're shaped. I go to the grocery store. You're shaped like branched dicks. And I don't like how you slice into it and you leave it on the counter and it becomes stringy.
Yeah. Okay.
And then Nigella Lawson describes ginger as having a spicy warmth. I go, shut up. It is... Yeah, it doesn't do anything. When was the last time a ginger shot kept you from having a cold?
Me, I...
Yeah, hi.
Damn it.
30 seconds.
It is not pulling its weight anymore. Ginger, you think it's the placebo, y'all. I'm telling you for a fact. It is not actually doing anything. You're eating something spicy and gross, and it's not actually good anymore. And Big seconds. Ginger is making all these candies now that make you feel like you're supposed to be healthy. No, I don't think so many ginger. You're shaped weird.
5 seconds.
I don't think we're ever supposed to have eaten you. We're supposed to have let you grow in the ground and take root.
That's 1 minute.
And be buried.
Look at the faces of your friends.
They're laughing. They're laughing.
That couldn't have been at us.
No, right? No,
I think they're laughing at us. If you're laughing at us, say woo!
Oh my God.
Oh no. I winked up this app.
Oh no. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Well, I think.
Now we're both embarrassed. You stand by your calamari. I don't think so, honey. This is a disaster.
Ginger
rocks. Is fabulous.
Yeah.
Really I'm sorry.
I've always thought so until I used it for a dish yesterday and I went.
What was the dish?
Yeah, tell
us. It was
us.
A curry.
And it belongs. It has to be in curry, doesn't it?
You would think. Too much.
Well.
Much too much.
Did you just put too much in?
That's on ginger.
That can happen.
That's on ginger.
Much like star anise has a big presence. Sucks up all the space in the room. Certain flavors really can't be, you can't share a dish with them.
No.
I don't think
and
the
I think
world
they're very
knows
self-conscious
you.
About it. I think they're very self-conscious about yes. it. I think star anise comes into the room and is like, hi.
Hey.
I'm sorry. It's
sorry
good
to
see
take
you
up
guys.
So much space.
And celery's like, fuck.
I don't think people know you as a culinary icon.
You are.
Has it been something you're holding back from the world?
Well, I mean, I don't think I'm a culinary icon, I'll say.
Giada is shook. Giada is shaking.
You know, I do like to...
Don't you feel Giada shaking?
I
think Giada De Laurentiis is shaking.
What does Giada De Laurentiis have anything to do with
I
this?
Think Giada De Laurentiis is watching this right now and being like, fuck, Ariana is good. She's coming for
she's
me.
She's cooking.
Yeah, she's cooking now.
I am cooking.
Yeah.
I like to cook. I do.
You?
I think that's enough of that. I don't think there's life there. I don't think that's interesting or adds value to this podcast. Who cares?
Who gives a shit?
What am I going to sit here and talk about, like, roasting mushrooms for the next 10 minutes?
Oh, my
no
God.
No problem.
Whoa. That's amazing. Tell more about that.
No, don't.
Well, you know.
Honestly, anyone
cooking
fascinates
me. Do you like king oyster
me.
Trumpet, like the trumpet ones?
The trumpet mushrooms?
Yeah, the trumpet ones.
I do like those.
There's so many different ways you can work those guys, you know?
They're beefy.
So many different ways you can work those guys,
no,
you know?
That sounded crazy.
It sounded
especially
just
about
right.
something that looks as phallic as it does.
There's so many different ways you can
no,
work these
No, but you
guys.
Can make them into little, like,
switching
scallops.
Up the
yes,
you can make them into scallops if you can saute them like that, or you can chop them...
I wish you were to see Food Queen because you know where I want to take her.
And roast, like bake them in their little chips.
Yeah.
I'd love that.
I want to take her to Brooklyn Crab.
Oh, yeah.
You'd I used like to work it. At this restaurant in Red Hook.
She can't
take
eat a thing
me.
There. You can't eat
you
a thing.
Can go. You can have a drink.
I can have the sides. That's the one thing about honestly, being a yeah. vegan. You really get yeah. to know the sides.
Sides queen.
That's right.
It's like, can I have the sautéed spinach? Is it in butter? You know? You got to ask.
You can ask.
Yeah. You know, you have to, you know.
Well, speaking of...
I told you that wasn't going to go
speaking
anywhere.
Of, so speaking of serving up a dish, here it is. So are you ready?
Yes.
So this is the moment. And it feels like you've now thought...
Well, I didn't know what I was going to do, yeah. but I feel like now that we've talked about it, I should use my yes, letter.
Absolutely.
Now is the time.
Use the letter. It's time for everyone to hear the letter.
This I don't is, think so, honey.
This is Ariana Grande's I Don't Think So, Honey. Her time starts.
Wait.
So this is going to be a different take on I Don't Think So, Honey. This is a historical artifact. It's a written document that really serves as an I Don't Think So, Honey.
Mm-hmm.
And here we go.
Here we go. This is Ariana Grande's I Don't Think So, Honey. Her time starts now.
I Don't Think So, Honey. The Guardians of the Galaxy ride in Disneyland, California. No offense. Said no. with much love and respect
mm-hmm.
for it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
An open letter to Disney World Orlando. Hello, I hope this finds you well. My name is Ariana Grande. I've been a frequent visitor and a great admirer of your park since I can remember. Some of my fondest adult professional memories have been collaborating on my cover of Alan Menken and David Zippel's tremendous hit, Zero to Hero, and performing in front of Cinderella's Castle along a magnificent choir that you so graciously provided. Further, some of my oldest and warmest personal memories include... spotting hidden Mickeys across the parks, yeah. driving up from Boca on the weekends, counting the purple signs, knowing we were nearing your parks, oh. and alas, dot, 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 riding the absolute masterpiece that is the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror for the first time once I was finally tall enough.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Perhaps this message comes prematurely, but I would be remiss if I did not reach out with a potential matter of grave concern. In the wake of the most recent alterations that have befallen your historic park in California. Yes, I am referring to the calamitous loss / makeover of the Tower of Terror ride here. I humbly implore you to not follow suit. Please allow the iconic and tremendous Tower of Terror to stand tall, mm-hmm. permanently, in the name of historical preservation, spooky honor, and good old-fashioned fun. I hope that you'll consider this humble plea from a passionate fan, and am I way over?
No, go.
While asking that my own passionate and devoted fans sign the attached change.org petition, just in case. I never posted this, but I really wanted to.
And that's 1 minute.
Are you my best friend, Aaron and I worked on this together during the pandemic.
You can tell it went through drafts.
Yeah, absolutely.
The vocab.
Yeah, we
calamitous
really just
loss.
Wanted to, yeah.
So you never sent it?
No, I never posted it.
Well, now it's
but
out
I was
there.
Ready. But it felt like there were more important things going on in the world.
Yeah.
So I didn't.
Well,
I just
there's always more important things going on.
I don't know. This was really up there. I'm kidding.
Here's the thing. Like,
I'm joking.
But it's not a joke. You know, I once created a change.org petition for Disney World, and it actually got a lot of signatures,
really?
Which was I did not want them to make Donald Trump in the Hall of Presidents.
Oh, good.
I was like, this would be ridiculous.
And
don't
they didn't.
Do it. And then
right?
they did.
They did.
Oh, they put him there?
They put him there.
Well, that's crazy.
So famously, you know what I'm going to say. So they started to make a Hillary animatronic because everyone was so positive.
And they scrapped it.
So when you go down to, if you ever go to the Hall of Presidents and you see the Donald Trump animatronic, he kind of has Hillary's face.
No.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about exactly what I said, Ariana. I'm talking about exactly what
scary
I said.
Scary times,
like,
everyone.
But literally, he's got the face shape. You can confirm this, right?
100%.
So he's got her face. I can't say anymore.
Sure.
I'll post it. But like, I did a change.org and it did some numbers.
And we will post. And we will post the change.org petition. That you're referring to.
You know what? I don't want to rock the boat.
No.
Too late.
This is a duty. Yeah,
that's true. It is too late.
Consider the boat rocked as fuck.
It is too late.
No. It's okay. As we say goodbye.
Why was this so good? I had been waiting to meet you, like,
when
ever
we
since
we finally met.
I know. And also, I felt like it was the SNL after party, and there was so much going on. And I literally, like,
you had a glow around you. You had a halo around you coming towards me, and it felt like an angel descended from the heavens. I was literally like, this person, because we've messaged and I know you, and we know each other.
DMs every now and then.
Yeah, absolutely. But I was just, I told Bowen, I was like, oh my goodness, he has such a disarmingly warm energy.
He's warm.
I am so obsessed with him.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I felt like I was meeting Ari, and so it was just like I gave her a hug, and I'm like, I just want to say that, you know, and I started to I could have this conversation with her later about how meaningful it is to me that you were there for him when he was going through things. And I just you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I just always felt very connected to you because I could tell that my friend had a friend.
Same.
And so anyway, that's how I feel about that. And you just are such a sensation in this movie and in everything you do. And
we love you because we knew you.
We used to sing for good.
Need to hear that.
Yeah. I was Elphaba.
I was Glinda. I'm Glinda.
That's tracks.
Tracks.
It does.
It really does.
We had it together there for a while.
We had a great rendition.
There was once a video of us like.
I feel like I have seen it, but what? I want to see it in person.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know.
We gotta do it. We'll do it soon.
We'll do it someday. But it's so emotional to get through. Oh, yeah. Forget about For Good. That must have been crazy shooting that.
I was hovering outside my body for 2 weeks. I literally was out of body for 2 weeks. And also, we shot it on a rain cover day. So it wasn't even supposed to be when we were shooting it.
Got you.
Which I loved because love not over rehearsing or knowing fully. Mm-hmm. You know, when you know the girls, you can just jump in and do what you're supposed to. You know, yep. It's fine. And we just were, it was a lot. We had to do, movie 2's going to be a lot.
I can't wait.
We're not allowed to talk about it much, but I just will say, it's gonna feel different.
Yeah.
Everyone that was like, it should be one movie, like, you're gonna feel silly.
No.
Like, I think you'll understand once you see it that there's just simply too much. There's too much to get through that deserves and needs to be honored and explored and fully represented.
Yeah.
We've got one shot to make these movies, you know, until they remake it and, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
No. But, you know, it's we had to get it right. There's so much story that deserves the time.
Got it right.
Thank you.
So did you.
You are brilliant. I love you both so much. Thank you for having me. This was so much fun.
We end every episode with a song. Switching up positions for you. Catching it in the bedroom. Now you not knowing it in front of her.
I know it. I was coming.
You just you picked a strange key.
We're done.
Bye.
Las Culturistas is a production by Will Ferrell's Big Money Players and iHeartRadio Podcasts.
Created and hosted by Matt Rogers and Bowen Yang. Executive produced by Anna Hosnier and Hans Sani.
Produced by Becca Ramos. Edited and mixed by Doug Bame and Monique Laborde.
And our music is by Henry Kabersky.
Hey everybody, it's me, Matt Rogers, letting you know tickets are on sale now to see me on tour. The Prince of Christmas tour, that is. I'm doing my whole album, Have You Heard of Christmas, plus a lot more with the whole band all throughout December. Go to www.mattrogersofficial.com to see me in a city near you.